Hi, I'm Rudy Winston from Canon USA, and it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague at Canon, Drew MacCallum. Drew and I work on the product planning team at Canon USA. Really welcome this opportunity to speak about the two powerful new cameras that we're bringing out in 2022, the Canon EOS R7 and the Canon EOS R10. Two very important new cameras with a smaller APS-C sized imaging sensor that bring a new dimension into the Canon EOS R camera system.
This is really, like you said, exciting for all of us, simply because that APS-C format really brings a lot of benefits to advanced amateurs, entry-level photographers, to get all kinds of the benefits that the R system initially was brought to light for. The advantages of new lenses, new AF systems, like you said, we're incorporating so many features from the higher end that we've learned in the full frame into the R7 and R10 that there's very little compromise in the terms of autofocus with these. And that is one conversation, is what do you lose from APS-C? And that's very little.
Things like their focusing systems and so on are really a very exciting thing that we're bringing into this price category. One thing that I want to just clear up right from the start is there may be a bit of confusion. The way Canon names camera products when there's a number in the name actually makes a certain amount of sense. The lower the number, the higher end the product is. So if you think of it in that term, then you understand the R10 versus the EOS R7. I know a lot of our nature, wildlife, and sports photographers historically have loved about APS-C when we were in the digital SLR era, was that any lens you put on the camera, you in effect got more telephoto power out of. So if you were already a telephoto person, so to speak, APS-C just leverages that without gaining an ounce of weight and without losing any lens aperture or anything else. All of a sudden, your lenses become more powerful.
Right, especially in a wildlife world where you're working with a 1.6 crop factor, if you will. That's kind of the easy math. So your 300 millimeter lens becomes a 420 millimeter at the same aperture. Right. That gives you a great effective reach to get out there and get to maybe the small animals that are a little more skittish and you can't really get there with a 300. That extra little reach you have is definitely a big bonus.
On the same vein, you maintain that lightweight and portability in the lenses. Even if you have the means to go out and get the big white super telephotos, the 600 millimeters and so on, the fact is if you can work with a smaller lens, just things like following a bird in flight or whatever it might be suddenly become a lot easier. And that's one of the benefits that the APS-C imaging sensor brings to the table.
Right, and like we said, the R10, even though it's categorized as a step below kind of our entry APS-C in the R build, you're still getting the same basic AF system that you see in the R7. So even then, you don't lose a whole lot.
The autofocusing in these cameras is really one of the major messages. The power of this system. And I know you've had a chance to work with it fairly extensively.
We've taken what we've seen from the R3 and the capability to track a subject, whether it's the animal's eye, head, body shape, whatever it may be. I was photographing a squirrel in a tree the other day just because he was in my front yard. And I noticed that the camera was able to completely shape the AF system around the squirrel's body as it was pressed against the tree. It was perfectly outlined when it couldn't see the eye because the head was turned away. Once the squirrel turns its face right towards me, boom, it switched and locked right onto the squirrel's eye. And anyone who photographs small animals like this knows that sometimes at a distance, they can be hard to see, but it snapped right to the subject's eye. It sat there and was able to track that squirrel as it jumped from one branch to another. It was actually really impressive to follow a subject very easily, very quickly.
I think an important distinction to make is when we're talking about the whole idea of focus tracking. Just let's make sure we understand what we mean when we say that, because we're not talking about just follow focusing something continuously coming at the camera. The example you gave with the squirrel is a perfect example, and I'm sure many of our viewers have found themselves in these situations where the tracking system will move with the subject to change the location of where it's focusing. And that is just such a liberating thing.
And such a big move from what we're used to of using the point, keeping the point on the target, letting the camera go and trusting the camera to track the subject. That's something you have to get over, but it's something that you will get comfortable with.
No man-made machine is perfect, but there's a level of trust that photographers who are using modern mirrorless cameras begin to build up if you just work with the technology and learn what it can do.
Even when you look at the way that you move AF points with the R3 to the point where you almost don't have to use your multifunction controller, your joystick, if you will, to move it around. That's one of those things I really, really enjoy when I first saw even the drawings of the camera was where the quick control dial was located. It's actually, instead of being on the back of the camera down low where it has been found for many, many years, it's been moved up to the top where your thumb naturally falls and incorporates the joystick now. So that quick control dial is right there to do any exposure compensation, and as you said earlier, can be customized as well. But it's right there with that joystick for AF points or menu selection, and it's right in a very natural spot for most of your shooting needs when you're holding the camera. We just came out with a new RFS mount lenses for these cameras. These are totally new lenses for these, for the APS-C size sensor. However, these lenses are not dedicated specifically to the R7 or R10. You can take either one of these two RFS lenses and put them onto your R5, your R6, your RRP, even the R3, and it's fully compatible. The cameras will jump into crop mode and you're instantly working. Not only that, but all of the other RF lenses that we've introduced previously are fully compatible with the R7 and R10 as well.
Right, so both of these cameras allow you to use either lens natively without an adapter. The RF lenses and now the RFS lenses dedicated for the smaller APS-C sensor. But as you said, they'll work on the full frame cameras. They just automatically put the camera into crop mode because that's the area that those lenses project back into the camera.
Right, and of course we always have that RF-EF adapter. So if you do have previous EFS lenses or EF glass, again, fully compatible with both of these cameras.
That's gonna be huge, I think, for a lot of our customers coming from digital SLRs. So you really have a rich selection of optics to pick from, whether they're already in your bag or whether they're things you're thinking about adding.
Exactly.
To maintain the compact size and form factor, you've got the smaller, what Canon calls an LPE17 battery pack on the R10 model, whereas on the R7, we've got that same LPE6 style battery that we've been using for so long in our mid-range cameras, the 5D series on our digital SLRs, and of course, the R5 and the R6 and so on our mirrorless cameras. Both of the cameras take SD memory cards up to UHS-II speed, so they'll take the fast SD memory cards. In the case of the R10, of course, you've got one card slot. In the case of the R7, you've got two SD card slots.
That comes in super handy when you want to either A, dual record your files for safety, if you want to have both JPEGs shot to two different cards, or maybe you want to shoot RAW to one card and JPEG to another. There's all kinds of different reasons you would have two card slots aiming towards that slightly higher end photographer. So two cards will come in super handy for that.
Right. Another big area where these cameras advance the capability beyond any place we've been when we're talking this kind of price category is in what we can just think of as performance, shooting speed, and so on. And, you know, again, you've had a chance to play with these extensively in the field. with both of these cameras using the mechanical or first curtain electronic shutter, you're talking 15 frames a second with autofocus. Let me say that again, 15 frames per second with autofocus using mechanical or first curtain electronic shutter. It is stunning. There's only one camera on the market currently that can shoot faster than that with a mechanical shutter, and that's an EOS 1DX Mark III digital SLR. Both of these cameras put that kind of power in your hands.
It's hard to imagine that we have that much speed in these products, but yeah, at 15 frames per second, whether it's a bird in flight or something that's coming down to grab a fish out of the water, or maybe it's a kid playing soccer, 15 frames per second can really give you that image that's in between almost there and there. That's what 15 frames is there. It's not so you fill up your card so fast, but it's that decisive moment of the scoring goal. Even when you do want to get the extreme speed, you can move to the electronic shutter, and you're getting significantly faster frame rates at 20, 30 frames per second in electronic shutter, and you're able to really get that shot. I mean, that really does mean you're getting a ball on a bat. Mm-hmm. That's really impressive.
And for people that are doing wildlife, another obvious advantage is that you've got the option with electronic shutter of having your operation be essentially silent.
Not electronic shutter, but silent mode that turns off all sounds, that turns off any beep, any flash functionality, any kind of sound that would be made from the camera, but instantly turn to a silent mode. Maybe you're a guest at a wedding or some event where something important's happening and you don't want to be that person. You can instantly quiet everything down and no one would ever hear you.
So, a question people may have, two new cameras that seem on the surface to be similar in a lot of ways, which one might be preferable for what kind of customer? I think clearly if you start with the R10, the value proposition is off the charts in terms of that combination of image quality, focusing performance, tools in the camera, customization and so on that we talked about, and the raw performance and the video capabilities. It's a fantastic multi-image content creation type of tool, but with a dose of performance and focusing capability that you just haven't been able to find in this price category. 24 million pixels in the case of the R10 camera, but 32 million pixels in the case of the R7. And that means that, you may be thinking, well, wait a minute, all this talk about action and so on, I don't really do that kind of thing, and I don't do much wildlife, but I like to shoot landscapes. I like to shoot close-ups and macro. Well, again, 32 million pixels puts you in fairly rare air in terms of the amount of detail that you're going to get in your images.
I do want to point out that this is a different 32 megapixel sensor than what we've seen previously in some of our other cameras, mainly the 90D and M6 Mark II. So this is a different sensor. So you're going to see a different image quality and performance.
Yes, it has evolved.
So Rudy, one question a lot of our customers might have, that they have an M series, something maybe our M50 or something along that line. Why would I move into this? They're both APS-C size cameras, right? They're both APS-C size sensors. Well, one thing I would say, and as you move into either one, the R10 or R7, your functionality of where the buttons are laid out, how you access the menu items, and how you access some of the exposure compensation, all of that, as you move up into this more advanced type camera, gets easier. You've started to outgrow your M50 maybe a little bit, and you want something a bit more responsive for those moments where you're changing quickly. These were built to help you access those functions much faster, and now you have the full openness of the RF mount and all the lenses therein, which I think we're now at 27 lenses, if I remember correctly in the numbers. We now move into a much more lens robust system.
That's a great point on both of these cameras. And certainly, if you look at the R7, we add on top of that a really excellent array of additional features and performance and build quality and so on And on top of that, just the ability to go in and make your images your images. And both of these cameras, as we said, can easily be made into your camera. Whether you already own a camera or you're looking to get into your first real interchangeable lens camera for different types of content creation, is the potential that both of these give you without overwhelming you in the beginning.